I almost apologize to you for being like cracking the whip, but I don't. Because the salvation of millions rests upon the decisions I think you guys make, honestly. So we're going to keep buckling the belts, girding up our loins a bit more, and we're going to run hard till 4 o'clock, at which time we'll stop and do more planning again. All right, let me set up Kevin Greason for a moment. How many of you guys have heard the name Kevin Greason before? Okay. Rock star in the Christian kingdom of God world, okay? Kevin and I went to seminary together, okay? And honestly, I would not have described Kevin as a tiger in seminary. I'm sorry, bro. And I'm over on my side of the world in East Asia. He's over in South Asia, and I keep hearing this name, Kevin Greason. Like, can't be the same guy. And God did something to this man, and he became a tiger among Muslims.
He got out of the cave.
He got out of the cave. And so what we're going to do is, and you know, just like Stan is connected to a lot of movements, this guy is connected to so many, especially Muslim background movements to Christ. By the way, Stan and I were talking about this. Some of the Muslim background guys said, we don't like being called Muslim background believers any more than you like being called an alcoholic background believer. We're just believers, okay? But anyway, you get the idea. So Kevin, I'm going to give it to you, bro. Okay. And if you want to do it,
nothing wrong with that.
This presentation is going to focus on pre-Pentecost models and practical suggestions and handles and methods, and basically we're looking at Jesus as our strategy coordinator model, and we're going to try to learn from him. We have a lot to learn from Paul. We have so much to learn from Paul. But this SC, this one, I'm talking about this one right here, I need a lot more information on 0 to 1. I would estimate 90% of what we get from Paul is the movement has already started. All those letters that he has written, they do drop us back. Some level, you can look carefully, you can see some clues as to how he helped ignite and facilitate that movement in Galatia, in Corinth. But it's speculative. I find myself needing more information. And this is the little journey that I have been on, is looking for more specific information on 0 to 1 with a movement. And the journey has taken me on from that side of Pentecost. Again, I want to repeat, there are so many lessons, and we do have clues about how Paul would go to an area. What would he do? For 3 Sabbaths, that was his habit. Both Acts 17 and Acts 19 say the same thing. For 3 Sabbaths, he would go into the synagogue and start where they are with their book, you know, Old Testament, you can say, and bringing them forward. And then it looks like he got a little frustrated with that and went to the Gentiles. But at least that was his pattern. Or we can say, if it says it twice, it looks like there's a pattern. This guy is looking for patterns. I'm looking for some handles like that. So I do have Paul, and we can grab so much, and Steve's going to take us on a journey to look at what we can learn from Paul. I have ventured over on this side of Pentecost, and we have been doing that in this meeting so far, and grabbing up some 0 to 1 practical pieces of information. The 4 fields that we have been talking about, fields 1 and 2, this person here, I go to pre-Pentecost because I find so much more information about practical things that I need to be doing and goals and where I should be working and not working and who I'm looking for and not looking for. I find those first 2 quadrants there, I find lots of information on that side of Pentecost. When churches have started, well, I find less information over on Pentecost, obviously. I find the next two boxes of the four fields, I find a wealth of information from that side of Pentecost, the after Pentecost. So this presentation is all about what we can learn from pre-Pentecost situation there. It's called Finding Fourth Soil, and it's on the little thumb drive. Steve is up here. This is yours? Or somebody's?
Somebody's. No, I don't have it yet. I will put it on there.
Okay. That, or you can just, this is going to sit right here. Anybody can grab this. So everything I'm presenting, even to, I think in 2 days I present again. I can't remember when it is. But it's also on here as well. This is a map of Naipaul district in Bangladesh. All of the districts in Bangladesh, there are 64 of them, and they're about the same size as Galilee. I love it that, I mean, we didn't plan on that, we didn't know that, but I've mapped them out and they look to be about the same size as Galilee with a whole lot more people inside of them. All the districts in Bangladesh have at least 1 million in there. This district called Naipaul has 1 million in it. So Heidi, back that out so that we can see where we are and then come back in. How do you do that? I don't know. Maybe, yeah, you got it. And come out even more so they need to see where we are in the world. Yeah, that far out. Yeah, yeah. There's the Indus, I mean, not the Indus River, but the Ganges River right there, and you can see India over there. Okay, and then flip off of the satellite and go on the map view. Okay, and then you can go ahead and get rid of this Naipaul district thing up there. Give this one. No, no. It's that arrow. You were so close to it. Go back up there.
There.
Yeah. Push that out. Okay. And then make it. Can you speed up the internet, please?
Start praying.
Yeah. Get off the internet, everybody. You're stuck in this thing right here. Yeah. All right. India is down over here. This is just a Bangladesh. You have that in your head. It's a Muslim country. In this story I'm about to tell is, and Heidi, as I'm talking, you can go back to that geographic thing and try to zoom in on that Naipaul district if you can find it. And I just want you to see. We decided at this one point, this would be 1998 or 99, somewhere in that period of time, we said, I'm ashamed to say this, but we said, I wonder if the scriptures are really what we ought to be doing, you know? I mean, isn't it a crazy thought to take your shoes off and to become needy and to just go into an area and just try to do as close as you can to what the scriptures say? It's just crazy to think like that, isn't it? Well, we tried it. And so we, there we go. There's Nepal, Bhutan. Now you see where we are in the world. And that you put a pin in it. That's great. So zoom in. I want you to find that little city that we discovered. I say little city. Little cities in Bangladesh. That's 100,000 people in the city of Gangi. So we decided, let's go experiment in Gangi. So I needed some people that didn't know any better and that just will do anything the missionary will say. So I reached over into Houston. There's a guy named Omar Garcia over at Kingsland Baptist. And I said, Omar, can you do something crazy with me? We want to read Luke 10, and we want to go try and do as close as we can to that and see what the results are. So we decided that Gangi was an area that wasn't, nobody had been there as far as we knew. It was 100,000 Muslims in this area there, and we had never been there. We had not worked in that area. We worked in the district right next to it and other districts out there, but never in that area there. So we decided this would be our target. We didn't talk to anybody along the way. Oh, does that sound familiar? Yeah. And we went straight to the place that we decided that this is where we needed to go. It was on our hearts to do that. I did keep my shoes on. Omar kept his shoes on as well. But we emptied our. There's no hotels in this. That's why I wanted you to see this. So if you could zoom in, are you lost now? Where's your pen? I think in this pink right there, that is Gangneung District at the bottom of the screen there. There you go. Thank you. And as she zooms in on this city, Gangneung, we got off the bus, we started walking, and we went in. And he does say make a lot of noise, doesn't he? He says, you know, don't hide your light under the bushel, you know, under the lampstand, but be loud. And we read that in the Matthew 9 passage, get extra loud, meaning share the gospel openly. And so this is a Muslim country now. Okay, there's some risk involved here. We don't have just a little bit of money in my wallet that would be a bus out. Nothing more than that. And so here we are, totally, you know, we have no hotel reservations. We don't know anybody in Gangneung. I don't have any translators with me. I'd learn how to speak the language there. Omar is with me. He's extra baggage. And so, no, he's my partner. And so we're going out there, and we just start sharing on the streets, just openly, sharing. Well, by the end of the day, we had exhausted ourselves. We were just tired, and it's getting dark. And I'm beginning to, God, didn't you say somebody is going to take care of us? I mean, where is that person? Of course, I wasn't going door to door as he told us to do and say, Salaam Alaikum. But not Salaam Alaikum.
As-salamu
alaykum. As-salamu alaykum. Yes. It's Shalom, isn't it? It's peace be with you. And by the way, that's the same thing that Salaam Alaikum means, right? I wonder if Jesus was getting us ready for Muslim evangelism. I just wondered that. And so we didn't find any house. Nobody's inviting us. Finally, it's dark, and there are this Muslim man, very kind guy, who came and said, what are you two crazy people doing out here at night? Where are you staying? We said, we don't know. And he said, okay, I'm taking care of you. And he puts us inside this, it's a tax revenue office that they had just built. I mean, it's real primitive. And they had just built this little room on the back. There's one bed in there, there's a fan, no netting on the window, and there's a toilet inside there. So we went inside there and bedded down. Now I know why Jesus sent us out in twos. Because when I was so tired, at 10 o'clock that night, we get a knock on the door. I open it up. Two Muslim men are standing right there. And I said, yes, can I help you? And they said, we heard you were in town and we want to talk to you. Now, my spiritual radar was off. I was so tired. I said, hey, I want to talk to you. Come back tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock in the morning and I will be so ready to talk to you. That's when I found out why God sent two people. Omar is right by the door there. He reaches up with his leg and kicks me in the rear. Talk to them. And that's all I needed. That's for that reason only, Jesus said, go to you. You're right. So I step out into the night, and in 2 hours, these men profess Christ. They pray to receive Christ.
Wow.
Yeah, it was an amazing thing. Can you come in and zoom in on that pink thing right there? Yeah, just keep, that's Chuadunga. Go up a little higher up there. And Gangneung just popped in. See it right there? And then turn on that satellite view right there. All right. I learned something, though. I decided that it was this time we had seen lots of Muslim men come to faith in Christ, but not Muslim women. And so I actually, as soon as these guys prayed to receive Christ, something in me, I don't know, I just said, hey, can I ask you a question? I need some help. We've been sharing the gospel just like with you, and men have been receiving this, but we think this is for women also. can you help us share this story that you just said you believe in? Can you help me? He said to me, be ready at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'll be by. I'll be by with my van, is what he said. So 8 o'clock in the morning comes. His van pulls up. Y'all know what a van is in Bangladesh? It's a three-wheeled bicycle. A little board on the back. So you just sit on the board, and so there's a little peddler guy, and he takes it. So we go outside of the city. Let's see. There's Gangi. Yeah, just keep coming in. Keep coming in as close as you can. So he takes us. I don't know which direction he was, but do you see how Gangi City is laid out there? We went out of one of these cities on the one of these roads. We go travel for about 30 minutes. Then we pull up into a village area. Houses are made of mud, thatched roofs. One two-story brick house amongst all of these other little thatched roof houses there. So we get out, we go into the house, we go upstairs, it's a two-story house, and inside the bedroom, there are 25 Muslim women sitting there, L-shaped, because there's a bed in there, and so they're around the bed like that, sitting on the floor, very just attentive, waiting for us. So we step through them, and we get up on the bed, and we do 2 hours of creation to the birth of Christ. And then I told you that we didn't have anything, but I did bring a Jesus film with me, okay? That's about all we had with us. So I said, hey, I have a movie in your language. Would you like to watch it? And they said, yeah. And I told them, it picks up the story from here. And so they said, yeah, we'd like to watch it. And so I said, I don't have a, this is 1998, so there was no, we didn't have CDs. These are VHS things. So I don't have a VHS player. I don't have a TV. So the person who had received Christ, I'm going to call him Four Soil Person, because he didn't put me up in his house, did he? Right? He didn't feed me. He didn't take care of me. So he must be another category. Maybe that guy who put us into that room would be, for me, a man of peace. He took care of us and put us in there. But I never saw him again, as far as I know. Then the fourth soul person said, this is one of those two guys that received Christ. He said, we'll take care of it. They go back into town. It seems like it was 30 minutes later. They come back out. They come out with a TV, with a VCR, and a battery, because there's no electricity out in the villages. And so they watched the Jesus film. That's another 2 hours. Now it's getting late in the day, and I'm getting hungry, and I think these people are getting hungry, but nobody's moving, nobody's budging. They're just, you know, the attention span of village women is really only 5 minutes. And here they are. They hung with us for 2 hours. That's impossible. That's unusual. And then we have another 2 hours of the Jesus film, and they're ready for more. Well, I'm ready to eat. So I'm looking for a little boy with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, Noah. And I don't have money to feed these people. And so I just brought that to the attention of the guy there, the fourth soul person, and he takes care of it. He goes into town, brings out, he's a very generous guy from his own money. He feeds everybody there. And so, and he's a poor guy himself. But he fed everybody. The meal wasn't that great. It was just a bag, a plastic bag. It had rice in there. It had dal in there. So that's all. I didn't say dog. I said dal. I know some of you. And we ate. And then we said goodbye to them and off into the night to another village. And we just stayed that way all week long. This place, that place, whoever would receive us. We never slept out under the stars or under a bridge somewhere. And so that was my first wake up to, it really does, you know, just doing the scriptures as close as we know to do it is amazing. All right, I sent an evangelist back in not long after we had left. He baptizes 19 people, and most of those were women for obvious reasons, right? That was turned out to be our target. And so he goes back in at the 6-month mark, and he doesn't do the baptism, because he's passed that on to them. And he finds that there are 125 that have now been baptized. This thing is growing fast. He goes back in at the one-year mark, and 300 have been baptized. Now, all along, there's some meetings with the for-soul person, training and just, teaching him the Bible and stuff like that, and him taking it back in and like that. Well, 8 years, 9 years later, like I said, we have been checking all along, but there were these other movements that had started and it really caught my attention, and I was focusing on them. But I asked that evangelist to go back in there. He did, and he comes out and says, man, there's way over 1,000. I don't know how many are in here. But we actually don't know how many there are today. The evangelist estimates over 3,000 baptized in this area here. This was a lesson for me to start paying closer attention to Jesus's instructions, not to be smarter than him, thinking I can do it and improve on what he said. This is a very humbling thing to do. There is a district right next to here where we were doing the same thing. And systematically, could you hang on to that word, systematically? Because I'm going to come back and revisit it. Systematically, we were moving through this district. It took us about 2 years, but we were systematically going every pathway that we knew we would go down at first. Because I have a bad back, I wanted to go down good highways, and so we did that, handing out tracts and stopping and showing the Jesus film and all that. And then we got off of that, and we started getting on bicycles. We put on some black pants, white shirt, name badge. We did not do that. But it felt like that. Did you know that? It felt just like that, you know? And so we would go down those village roads, and we were sharing with people, walking down paths, and getting in rivers. No missionaries that I know of have gone that far. That's where we found a lot of Muslims who were having these dreams on those paths where nobody has seemed to have gone before. That's where we're finding these amazing, somebody got there before us, and it wasn't a missionary, it was the Holy Spirit just beat us there and doing his thing. Yeah. We were learning so much. So that district, out of all of the sharing, and it was a massive amount of sharing that took place, about 6 people came to faith in Christ, nobody baptized. But there was this one who came to faith in Christ who, I'm shortening the story, but when we left, I went back to the capital city, he came to my house, found me, and was discipled there for 4 months. And then one day we get a letter from his mother who said, do not come back here, they're going to kill you. So I said to Manon, you really shouldn't go back there. That's really good advice from your mother. Don't do that. A flood, you saw some rivers there. You can back the camera up now. This district that I'm talking about is the one to the south. We've always focused on districts, moving from one district to the next. Come on out even more until you see this word Chuadunga. It'll be to the south. So there's a river flooded, and so I sent a truckload of rice out there. And Manon, without my permission, without me knowing, he jumps on that truck and goes all the way out there. And he goes to his village and he calls them together and he says, can I tell you what happened to me? I tell you the truth. And so he shared with them, and in the next 2 years, he started 24 churches. There was one highway that we couldn't go down. I didn't have the toll money to do it. I didn't have access to it, actually. This one road that we couldn't go down. And do you know the name of that road? Oikos. I'm a stranger there. I don't know people. I'm just moving around, just sharing crazy like a farmer who just throws seed everywhere. That sound familiar? And so I didn't know about this other road because I didn't have access to it. But he did, because you know where he went? Those 24 churches, those are all of his relatives. He would go to his relatives. You see, sisters are married off. Brothers stay in the house here, but sisters are married off. And so he would go to his brother-in-laws, he'd go to his cousin, he's going over there, and he's sharing with them. They wouldn't listen to me because I've been in those areas there. We share. I sent many teams in there. They wouldn't listen to me because it was a foreign message coming from a foreign mouth. But all of a sudden, the message came inside the mouth. The foreign message came inside a familiar mouth. And now he's saying to his people, his own family members, I was wrong. And listen to me. I'm going to tell you the truth now. We were living a lie. We were living this way. We were told this. This is the truth. And they believed it. And they saw the change in his life. Fast forward, 30,000 today in that district. At one point, I began to realize, it took me many, many years, but I began to realize, and in my table here, we had a good discussion this morning about, are we to see ourselves as the farmer in the parable or as the four soil person? For the longest time, I saw myself as the four soil person. I said, oh, okay, I need to be that, I need to do, you know, act like that, I need to, 100-fold sharing out there and all that. Well, we made a discovery. We said, well, what is the title of this parable? It's the parable of the soils? No. Is it a parable of the seeds? No. Jesus actually names this parable. It's the parable of the
sower.
It's about the sower. And he wants us to see ourselves. Now, if you're sharing with your own relatives, your own oikos, you're the four soil. But if you're a missionary in a new place, you won't believe how valuable this parable becomes for you. It only comes alive whenever you see yourself in a new place. I mean, that's what he was sending his disciples out to, these new places. Maybe they'd already reached their families, you know, maybe. And now they're going out to these new places, and he puts a tool in their pockets. And that's what I want to talk about today. Now, we have a problem here. Because we have this parable of the sower, we're going to see it as a strategy. But the person who gives us this strategy, by many scholars, they view Jesus, his ministry was a failure. I know that sounds really strange to your ears, but you'd be amazed how many scholars, when you go read their books or commentaries, really things broke out Pentecost. That was the breakout. That's whenever the movement started, you know? And so if there's really, you know, failure over on this side, why am I going to adopt a strategy from someone who couldn't even work it themselves, you know? Somebody presenting at your table there, oh, I have this strategy, and they share it with you, and then you dare to ask the question, well, have you used that strategy? Did it work? And they say, oh, no, we're just in, you know, it didn't, we haven't seen any fruit from it, but I think it's a good strategy. Are you going to listen to that? At your tables right now, you're going to work on something for me. I need to know, is Jesus a strategist? I know he's my Savior, he's your Savior, he's our Lord, he's our King, he's our Master, but I want to know, is he worthy of being my strategy coordinator, my mentor? Can I learn from him? I know that there's some good smiles out there and you're grinning, but we really haven't, a lot of us haven't adopted Jesus. Paul has already made it in that category. We're going to follow Paul. He's our mentor, we're going to follow him and everything. I'm asking you, and if Paul were here today, he would say, hey, I learned from him, you know? And you're going to see a lot of Paul's languages. Anytime he uses soil or sower or sowing, or you're going to see a lot of, I think he's referring to the parable of the sower. Anytime he talks about an agricultural description of his kicking off dust, he and Barnabas say this at least twice in Acts. Where did they get that dust kicking thing from, you know? Yeah. By the way, we're pretty sure of this, that Barnabas was one of the 70. Clement of Alexandria wrote exactly that in the 2nd century, that Barnabas was one of the 70. So we feel pretty good that he was one of those guys. So he's getting that training, and possibly he's handing it off to Mr. Paul. So Garrison wrote a book called A House, Wind in the House of Islam. When he did his research of all of these 69 movements among Muslims that he's found, he would use a little litmus test. He would say, I really don't want to research your movement unless there are at least 1,000 baptisms. That was his little measuring stick. There's nothing about 1,000 in the scriptures, okay? He's just reaching out there. There's so many movements that he could have researched, but he had to, I want to visit the ones that have at least 1,000 baptisms in a relatively short period of time. I want to take that, and I want to put it on Jesus. This little exercise I'm doing here, I'm actually helping you, as it was a help for me, to greater appreciate Jesus as a strategist. If he had results, if he had at least 1,000 baptisms, and he's going to give us his own strategy plan found in the parable of the sower, then I think it's worth adopting. I think it's worth grabbing hold of. If he didn't have a successful ministry, don't follow the parable of the sower as strategy. Y'all with me? I need to know, did Jesus have at least 1,000 baptisms before Pentecost? Okay? Drop the satellite view. Now, at your tables, you're going to talk right now and try to assume that I'm right, that he did have at least 1,000 baptisms. Prove it at your tables there. Okay? What can you think of? What scriptures can you go and grab and say, this is a good indicator that he had? You're not going to find any scripture that says he had 1,000 baptisms or more. You are looking underneath. You're looking to see if Jesus did have a successful ministry, and we're qualifying that. Did he have at least 1,000 baptisms? Not just believers, baptisms before Pentecost. What verses of scripture are you going to grab a hold of? What are you going to reach out there and say, this is a good indicator right here that he had at least 1,000 baptisms? Yes?
Directly or indirectly through his disciples?
Yeah, I didn't say his ministry had at least 1,000 baptisms. I didn't say he had to do it, but his ministry has at least 1,000 baptisms.
Before Pentecost.
Okay, you've got 7 minutes to work on that.
Thank you. there's been a few places where it's kind of seen there's crowds coming to the line, so then you just got that. We have, seven. John said the crowd's coming out to be baptized by him and the group of wipers. 400 people in the crowd, a bunch of people coming to the line. I don't really see like a same thing with Mark 1. And so John came baptized within the region of preaching about the repentance. All Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. Looks like the whole Judean countryside is getting baptized.
Game, y'all are doing so well. I'm going to interrupt your 7 minutes. I think I'm only getting about five. But y'all are so getting this. Let's just go with what we got right now. What do y'all have?
Okay, well, in Mark 1, verse 5, it says, the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins.
To John the Baptist.
To John the Baptist. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. And so at least, like, massive amounts of people from Jerusalem were baptized by John. In John chapter 4, the disciples of John were angry because the disciples of Jesus were baptizing more people than John had baptized. And so, if there's a number of people in Jerusalem we can tag, it was more than that John's, that Jesus' disciples were baptized.
A lot of the tables we're chasing, this is a great place to start, okay? I think we can get 1,000 baptisms off of this reasoning right here. Did anybody come up with something else, another topic, another idea? Lift it up some of the scriptures to see if there's something that helps us.
Yeah, we saw in 1 Corinthians 15 where Paul mentions that after the resurrection, Jesus appeared to more than 500 brothers. Assuming that those were already baptized followers of Jesus, and 500 maybe just referring to men or heads of households, not including their wives, children,
that's good.
Other members of the other council.
Speaking of Paul, it's 1 or 2 years after Jesus has died, Saul is going up to Damascus because there's this thing that has gotten out of hand. The movement in Damascus, and I'm going to say movement, because it already has a name. Now, I've tracked with movements. When movements take on a name, what was the name of the movement?
The Way.
The Way. It's established. This is 1 or 2 years. That's when Paul makes his journey up there to stamp that out, and he has his, because he's going up there because it's gotten way out of hand. The news from up there has gone all the way down here, and it's gotten out of control. We got to do something about that. That sounds like a lot of people are caught up in this movement called The Way. Number one, it has a name. All movements, the six movements that I've been associated with in Bangladesh, it was about 2 years into it, they got tired of describing what this is, and they decide, let's just give ourselves a name so that we can say, come join, and then instead of 10 minutes of explaining what it is, can you come join? One of the movements is called Way of Peace. Another one is Way of Life. You know, they started naming themselves whenever they got well over 1,000. Yeah. Any other ideas?
Matthew 4:23-25 says, he went throughout all Galilee, and his fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought to him all the sick people, and then great crowds followed him from Galilee, Decapolis, Jerusalem, beyond Jerusalem, Judea, and from beyond Jordan.
That's a lot of people. Guys, they were baptizing, okay? Baptism is not invented by John the Baptist or Jesus. It was taking place, the Essenes. Y'all heard of those guys? They were baptizing long before I say long before, just before Jesus came on the scene, they're baptizing. I'm standing at the Temple Mount on a little tour I was on. We're looking up, and the guide says to us, this is the side of the temple where we believe that Peter gave his sermon on that day. And he asked us all, everybody on the tour, said, can you all look to your right? And so we look over on the, here's the temple wall right there, and there's a slope right here. He said, we have discovered 52 baptismal pools, and we believe there are many, many more just right here. Have you ever thought about how they baptized 3,000 in one day? I mean, because if you do baptism the way we do it, all right, do this, hold your nose, or whatever, you hold their nose for them, I don't know if you could do 3,000 in one time like that. Most likely what they did was, Peter is standing there, and they did what the Essenes were doing, that we know how they were baptizing. You walk down in there, and you baptize essentially yourself under the authority of somebody who is there, and you walk out of that. All right, so baptisms were not something new. They were already taking place. Baptizing in the name of Jesus was something new, and we know that the disciples were doing that. Just for sake of time, and all these notes I have for you here on this thing, you can take this little Word document here, but you need to start doing a little math. It's okay to take on, we know that there are 82 disciples at one point. That's the 70 plus the 12. Can we assume that they are people who led, if they led their houses to Christ, how many people is that? So we're doing a little math here. This is on the bottom right here. Let's estimate that there's at least, at that time in history, the average family size was 5, but they didn't live like that. They had mother and father and grandparents and servants. I mean, houses, when they excavate houses at that time, there's a community that lived in there. It's big, you know, it has a courtyard, and these houses, and the rooms are all like that. So more than 5 people lived in that thing right there. And so we follow Cornelius, and we follow these people who are in Acts. It looks like, if it's the norm, the whole group household was in the household. If we assume that we can get up to 13 people in a household, and of the 82 disciples there, if only the 82 baptized 13 people in their house, you can get over 1,000 right there with that number there. It's a logical assumption that you can do there. We could have gone with 120. You know that the people who were in the upper room, there's 120 of them, they were all from the movement in Galilee. We know that those 120 were Galileans because the people say, these Galileans, number one, they're drunk, and number two, they're speaking how can these dumb Galileans be speaking my language? They call them Galileans, you know? And then when the angels come and say to the 500 there, men of Galilee, why are you standing here? So these are Galileans. They're from the movement that started up in Galilee, okay? You can research some of that a little bit more. What I want to do now is, I have read many scholars now, very conservative, good scholars. I've interviewed several of them, and this is what I've discovered. The parable of the sower contains Jesus' own strategy, own field strategy. Now, for academia people, they skip right over that. It represents his own field strategy. So what? You know, and so they continue preaching and sharing the parable of the sower, trying to get us in the pew to see ourselves as, which soil am I? That's the most popular way the sermon, the parable has been preached. Okay? So, and there's no reason for you to do that, because all three synoptic gospel writers have the parable of the sower in passive voice. He's not asking you to do anything. He's not asking you to put yourself in the story there, in the parable. He's telling you this is the way it was. Before Luke 8, the parable of the sower, we have chapters 4 through 7 where Jesus alone is going out and doing the... He's like a farmer. He's out there. He's the only one. Okay, John the Baptist is also over there preaching. But Jesus is basically... And the guys are watching him. Chapter 8 of Luke. Something happens. Chapter 9, we have 12 going out. Chapter 10, we have 70 or 72 going out. And a prayer for more. Pray, you know, he's looking at the 70 and he says, pray to the Lord of the harvest for more laborers to go out. Let's go back to that chapter 8. Jesus is going out alone before that. Now he's got all of these people going out. And it looks like the 12 were out for 6 months. One researcher comes to that conclusion based on Jewish ceremonies, and I don't see anybody correcting him, but it looks like they went out for 6 months. Okay, I don't know how long the 70 went out. It doesn't have, there's no clues for that as well. But stop and think about that. If we have lots of very conservative scholars, and I have them written there, if names mean anything to you, I put them on there, saying Jesus is, when he gives the parable of the sower, he's telling you how it was for him, what he was doing. This was my strategy when I went out. I'm telling it to you. You know the difference between passive voice and active voice. Active voice, he's going to give you a command. And there is a command connected to this parable. It's the only thing you'll find that's active voice throughout that whole little passage right there. Listen. That's the only active voice in that whole section right there. The whole parable is told in passive voice, which gives us a good clue that Jesus is saying, guys, you want to know what I've been doing? I'm going to describe it for you. Now, this is a massive crowd. I just read one scholar who's saying it's well over 1,000 people. He was estimating over 4,000 people, and he admits, he says, it's just a guess by his own, you know, his idea. If, how he can, you know, reaches that, I'll have to explain it to you another time. But there's a lot of people standing there receiving this parable. They're not hostile, by the way. There's no fighting, you know, with the Pharisees in there. This group is a mob. That's a mob. It's a crowd, not a mob. It's a crowd who have just suddenly come from every place. You read Luke 8, 1, right before the parable is given. Can somebody read that? Luke 8, 1.
Now it came to pass afterward that he went through every city and village, preaching and bringing the glad the good news of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him.
Luke wants us to know that. Jesus has been out there preaching and sharing all over the place, kind of like what somebody right here read earlier, Matthew 9:35. Jesus has gone to all of the towns and villages all throughout. And you'll find that theme throughout the Synoptic Gospel writers. You'll see it there. You'll see it in other places. The writers want us to know Jesus was covering. Did he go to all of the, and I told Steve the other day, yesterday, 204 communities in Galilee. How do I know that? Josephus wrote that. He said in Galilee, there's 204 villages or communities, you can say cities. So, we're going to work on that. But before we do, I want to help give an idea of how to do, how to write up your strategies. Okay? Do y'all remember, those are my age and older, we didn't have computers. You go to the encyclopedia, and in the very back of the encyclopedia, they have these the frogs that have been dissected, and they have pages back there of, you flip this, there's a thing, it's clear. It has the frog on there, you flip, and there's an overlay. Then you start seeing what's underneath and all that. Remember those?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody else, you don't know what I'm talking about.
Yes, I do.
Yes, you know, because you're as old as me. I want to know Listen to this. If the parable of the sower, Jesus' own strategy, how to start a movement. Because if you're going to find a hundredfold person, that's a movement, by the way. Hundredfold, you find 200-fold people, that's a lot of hundredfold plus another. This is how movements start. There is this person out there. Jesus wants his people to know. It looks like it's real hard. You know, it looks like you're not going to be seeing any fruit. It's going to feel that way. But it's out there. That's what the parable is for. There is a force. It's not telling us to be the four-soul person. He's telling us, and he's not telling us to find the four-soul person. He said, it just is. You go out and share like a farmer, and I've seen a lot of farmers in my life over there in the mission field. I mean, this looks like the time that Jesus is about the same. People are plowing with a wooden thing, you know, and they're throwing their seed. I have never seen a farmer throw the way this farmer does. No. Point well taken, Jesus. This farmer is throwing seed like crazy, you know, up on a road. In the bushes, no field have I seen does it have weeds already inside of it, you know, or rocks inside of it. But Jesus is trying to make a point. This is sowing the gospel everywhere. Haven't you guys been seeing me go through Galilee, my target area? I've been going to all the cities and places, sharing and sharing. And guess what? I'm doing this whenever I'm sharing. I'm looking to see what happens, what comes up. And I want you guys to pay attention to that, because that's how we're going to start a movement that's going to go around the globe. There are going to be this one person buried out there who is going to come up. Y'all heard me use this illustration, some of you. But if I had a haystack that is 10 feet tall, 10 feet wide, and last night I took a needle and I put it inside that haystack. Austin, how long do you think it would take you to find that needle if you just started into it and trying to find it? And by the way, no matches, no magnets, and no metal detectors. Okay, just the old-fashioned way, just finding that needle. How long would it take you to do that?
A long time.
A long time. It could be days. But if I said to you, go get 12 people, train them how to find a needle in a haystack, now how long would it take you? A little less time. We're talking maybe hours or less. What if I told you, go get 70, train them, now go after that needle? We're talking minutes. We're going to find that. Do you see how many gold nuggets there are on this side of Pentecost of finding the people? And you've also heard me say in the trainings, not a one of you in here are likely going to start a movement. I know we have that vocabulary. I'm like, I'm going to go start a movement. I need you to not think like that. Unless you're among your own oikos, your own family, and you're winning them, yes, you're a four-soul person. You're starting a movement. But most of us are missionaries. You're going into new neighborhoods. You don't know anybody. You're going over there. You're going here. You don't have access to oikos. That's the secret. The man in the tombs, when he becomes a believer, Jesus says, go to your... He actually uses the Greek word oikos. Go to your oikos. We don't have access to oikos. So let me say it this way. None of you in this room are likely to start a movement. Most people get real depressed. Man, I came here to do this. That's what I'm all about. I want to start a movement. You can try. Very frustrating if you don't have the oikos factor working for you, you know? You're a stranger in a new place. You're a missionary. Your job, in fact, I think that's what I'm getting from the parable of the sower. Your job is not to be the fourth soul. Your job is to find the person who's going to start the movement. Oh, okay, that's a little bit easier. I can do that. I can go and find the person who's going to start the movement. Was it Ray yesterday? Just, you know, said something about that. I've forgotten it already. I remember when him saying yesterday, you're one person away from a movement. Very true words. I have researched, I've been a part of six movements, zero to several thousands today. I have researched very, very closely 18 movements, two in Pakistan, six in North India, eight down in Bangladesh. I know how they started. I've gone to there. I've researched. I know the people involved in that. And not a single missionary started those movements. But I can trace a missionary involved in finding the person who starts and leads those movements. Okay? Now, how are we going to find? We now know we're not going to lead a movement. We're going to go find the person who's going to start the movement. Kevin, give me some clues. How do we find that person? What does he look like? I mean, I read a book a few years ago on how the FBI finds top teners. You know what I'm talking about? Top 10 most wanted list. How do you think they find top teners? They contact their relatives and, you know, where is so-and-so? Where's your son? You know, he's killed 10 people and, you know. That's one way. But as FBI find top teners, let's apply that. They learned from us, okay? But now we're having to learn from them how to find top teners. Well, in order to find a person, you got to have like a profile of that person, right? What does he look like? What does he eat? What are his habits? What kind of car does he drive? You know, you put all that together, you can come up with a profile, and it really, really helps finding that person when you have this kind of information about that person. My question to you is, do we have a profile of a for soil person? Come on, yes. Yes. We know what he doesn't look like from the parable of the sower, and we also know some things that he does look like just by looking in the parable. He's giving us clues how to find the people who start movements, the people who have a hundredfold fruit, meaning souls won. So up on the map here, or on the document, come scroll up. Look at this box right here. Characteristics of a four-soul person, what I learned from the parable of the sower. Number one, they're saved. Fourth soil is saved, okay? He's not going to want to be saved. He is saved. This person accepts Christ. He's a believer, okay? That's the beginning of our little profile. Number two, they pass through soil number two, okay? Soil number two becomes a believer, says, now, I don't have time to deal with that fall away thing, okay? It's not what you think. It's not a fall from grace. In fact, Mark, the word that he uses in the parable of the sower, that they stumble, they fall away, there's only one time you'll find in the remainder of Mark that that word, fall away, is used. It's the disciples. On the night that Jesus had the Lord's Supper, they said, we'll never. And Jesus said, yes, you'll fall away from me tonight. Okay? That's the only time. So it's not fall from grace. Okay? But I'll have to leave that with you for that. But this person says he believes with joy, but he doesn't reproduce. Why doesn't he reproduce? He's scared. If you have a new believer, okay, here's how it works. You're out there sowing, and the parable tells us, pay attention to seeds coming up. Analyze them, process through those. And you're looking, and you see a believer, I believe, but I can't share with anybody because they'll kill me. I can't share with anybody. That's a soil number two person. Soil number three, he doesn't reproduce because he is, skip down that next one there. He's with money. I'm sorry, number two right here. Number three soil, he doesn't reproduce because of money and cares of the world. Those are the two things that Jesus says about this soul number two. Oh, I'll lose money if I start sharing Jesus here at my workplace. I'll lose everything if I do. And what will happen if I start sharing? Oh my goodness, what will, you know? And they close their mouth and they don't reproduce. So you know you have a soul number three if he is like this. Then he also, I want to point out that this, what's the opposite of someone who's very stingy with their money?
Generous.
It's a generous person. When Jesus describes the four soul person, he says, this man has a good and noble heart. All right? Now, do some research. Go dig around and see. When you take, you'll find that scholars will say, when you, in that day, when you had good and noble in the Greek, when you put good and noble together, it likely, and again, I have this whole paragraph here of scholars who are saying, most likely, this is what it means. Can't be exact on this, but it means a generous person. Good and noble means a generous person. If you have a person, just like that man who I told you about earlier that started the movement in Gandhi, you know, he used his own money to feed all of these people and this, the 25 Muslim women and others that were in the room. He's a generous person. If you have a person who is generous, there's another clue right there that you possibly have a four-soul person. And then, of course, they attempt to produce a hundredfold fruit. If they're opening their mouth, how do you produce a crop? You open your mouth and you share the word of God with your oikos. That's how you start a movement. If they are opening their mouth, sharing with their people, then they are good. These are good indicators. Now, Kevin, this is Jesus up on the top side telling us what a four-soul person looks like. This is me talking down here. It's not from the scriptures. They tell their oikos about their community. That doesn't say that in the scriptures. Kevin is saying, I've studied a lot of people who have started movements, and that's what they do. They turn around to their family. By the way, you don't have to disciple them to do that. Oh, I've got this guy, he's a believer, and I'm giving him everything and discipling him and trying to give him all this stuff, and he just won't go and share. I'm going to stay a little bit longer, maybe another year of just pounding him with it. He'll start. The parable teaches us, don't go make for soul people. Go find them. Many of you are frustrated, and I can hear it. You're frustrated. I'm trying to... some people want me to come do training on how can we get soil number two and number three turn into four soil people. I don't know. Jesus gives us some clues, but don't bother with that. Don't make four soil people. Go find them. How do you know if you found one? He's going to turn around and he's going to win his oikos. He's going to at least share with them. They have sin in their lives. I put this on here. Obviously, not all of the people have huge addictions or things like that, or prostitute that comes to Christ, or a tax collector that cheats everybody in town. Not everybody is like that. But of the 18 movements that I have studied, most of them, not all, but most of them, people had this huge, they were the known sinner, and they came to Christ. The reason why I put that on there is because many missionaries that I supervise and help them process whether they have a four-soul person or not, they will discount a chain smoker. How can a chain smoker start a movement? No, you have to clean up your life. You have to become pure, and then you can, you know. No, that's only in the movies. You know, it doesn't happen like that in real life. The woman at the well, how much time does she have to go clean up her life, go to seminary, and be effective out there? She just went. Guys, here's a lesson for you. A movement, pre-Pentecost movements, are an atomic bomb explosion of people believing. Just believing. Not becoming super powerful Christians. That's coming. But watch that nuclear bomb of just believe, 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 believe. Then we have behind that sanctification. We have justification. We have, you know, that's just believe, a nuclear bomb of just belief going on. And Jesus says, don't throw those people out. I know that people came and joined our group and they're only after the miracles. I know that. He tells it in a parable. He said, some guy comes in and sows weeds among the wheat, you know? And the disciples are probably saying, hey, there are people here that are just for the miracles and for the show and all that, those powerful stories you tell. And Jesus tells them a parable, probably answering that right there. No. That's my problem. That's not yours. You just share and let people believe, and it'll all come out in the end. I don't want you doing that job, okay? It's my problem and not yours. You just share and work with people in that way. Their vision is often bigger than your vision. You can just hear it. It's almost as if that next one right there, you can ask a person who is a possible fourth soul person to pray, and you'll listen to them, and they'll say, God, give me Scotland or I die. You know, give me my people. My people have been like, if they start, I call it the Moses syndrome, that let my people go. They take ownership for a big block of people. This is probably a fourth soul person that Jesus told us about. Their security level makes you feel uncomfortable. When they first are saved, they're hot and ready for action. Don't make them go through some kind of passage, because we need that nuclear bomb explosion of belief to go out. Then we can grow them, and they'll form churches automatically. But we're going to be a part of that process. All right. The last little exercise that I want you to do, go ahead and go up. Thank you.
What do you mean by their security level makes you feel uncomfortable?
Well, I'm in Pakistan, and this person says, we need to get out there and share. And I'm saying, what? That's crazy talk. Okay, so in Pakistan, I had to get over my little fear factor, but one day I went out sharing. I shared with, how many people in that one day? I think it was around 15 people I shared with in one day. One, the next day I got back with that, it's a taxi driver, and he said, you remember that story? And he says to me, when he comes to faith, that one person out of the 15, he says, hey, I'm not from this area. Let's go up to my city up in Islamabad, you know, Rawalpindi area up there. And what you just share with me, you're going to share with 10 people I'm going to put inside this house. Now, this guy is only 5 minutes old in the faith. He just prayed to receive Christ, and he has this plan. And this plan is bold. And this plan is, I'm going to get 10 people, put them in the room. What you just told me, you're going to tell them. Okay. And then I said, but I got to go to the airport right now. My mistake for not jumping on where God was at work. He interrupted me because I interrupted him. He said, I'm not finished. I said, there's more to your plan. He said, then I'm going to make those 10 share with 10 each. And it will cover all of Pakistan. That's a dangerous strategy. Bold. I can't even find those words. I can't even say that because I know people are going to get killed from that kind of strategy like that. So he had more boldness than I did. His security level was, who cares? In fact, that's what he told me later. Said, I know they're going to kill me. I know they're going to kill me. Tell me that story one more time is what he said. Tell me the gospel one more time because I will make sure that when I die for the right cause. I don't talk like that. His security level is much more out there. I want you to reread the parable and see it as strategy. So I'm just about out of time here. In fact, I think I am out of time. But what the exercise that I was going to have you do is, and so I'm going to tell it to you, and I want you to do this in your mind at some point, maybe tonight. If the parable of the sower does represent Jesus' own strategy, if Jesus had a successful ministry before Pentecost in his target area of Galilee, I think I ought to adopt that as my strategy. Just as those in the encyclopedia, those overlay, I want you to think about your strategy that you're writing for this week here. right there on that paper, and I want you to take what you understand of Jesus' strategy coming from the parable of the sower and lay it on there. And see if yours matches up with his. Try to write your strategy that looks a lot like his. In order to do that, I need to just explain to you what I mean by that. Up more. Here's what I understand from the whole passage there. He chose a geographic area. He chose a people group, the Lost House of Israel, inside that geographic area. Okay? Why don't you choose a geographic area and a people group inside that geographic area? I'm so crazy that why don't you choose an area about the same size as Galilee? Why not? I think Paul, I'm still researching this, but Paul had Galilees. I mapped out one where the Ephesus and most of those Thessalonica or all of those, that's one movement there. And I took Galilee and I overlaid it. That's exactly the same size because we know the cities that he says this movement broke out in. This city, this city, this city, this city. And I just took those and I overlaid Galilee. Happened to be the same size. It's just speculation on my part that probably those movements that Paul had started were probably regions rather than just a little individual church. It was a movement in a region. So the Pakistan team, we chose a district in Pakistan that's the same size as Galilee. Why not? All these countries seem to be packaged just the right size for us. Bangladesh, all districts are about the same size. In the U.S., counties, actually it's a little bit different. I've noticed that most counties in the U.S., it takes two counties together to make the average county size. It makes two of them to make a Galilee. Okay? And you need somewhere between 200,000 to 2 million people. They don't know, it's quite a spread there, but they don't know how many people were actually in Galilee at that time. But it doesn't matter because if there's a people group inside there. Jesus said, we're going to first go to the lost house of Israel, sends those guys out. Okay? So my question to you is, do you have a Galilee? Do you have a target geographic area? Well, who's in that Galilee that you're going after? Which people group inside there? As a supervisor, I find it very hard to help people be accountable when they just choose a people group all over the map. We can't systematically, and why do I say systematically? Luke chapter 10, we've already read it today. Jesus is sending his guys out to places that he himself is about to go. Does that sound strategic to you? Does it sound like he's covering Galilee systematically? Are you, like a farmer, systematically covering your Galilee? Does that make sense? So choose a Galilee, target a specific people inside that Galilee, do the work of the farmer. I ought to be able to look at your strategy, and I ought to, man, you look like a crazy farmer. You know, I'm looking at all the things you wrote on your strategy there. That looks kind of wild seed sowing there. Pull that out of me. When I look at your strategy, try to pull that expression, that reaction out of me. It looks like you're looking for somebody, you know? You look like you are trying to cover this whole area with the Word of God. Got it? But it's going to be slow going if you're going to do this all alone. So in a year, at least train at least 82 people. I don't know if that's just a number I reached out there and grabbed because Jesus had 70 plus 12. I don't know if it's 1 year, but it's a good goal for you. At least 82 people you have trained to go out and find that needle in a haystack. There's a movement, the one that took place, I just described it for you. It's over 30,000 today. Now I'm working over in another place in Bangladesh. Rohingya are a bunch of Muslims, refugees out of Myanmar. They're in Bangladesh. I don't know how many, somewhere between 500,000 to a million of them are just in this area down in the southeast corner of Bangladesh. So as Stan was talking about, I went to that movement of 30,000. It's way over on the other side of the country. And I said, hey, can I show you a strategy? I didn't come up with it. And so we just went through parable of the sower. And all of a sudden, the leader of that movement has, you know, we used to just go out sharing and hoping that some people would become a believer and all that. But you have made us laser sharp now with your, we know what we're doing. We know exactly how to reach our goal because we have a target out there. We're going out, and by the way, I said, do you have 70 disciples that you could send down into that southwest corner down there? He said, 70 schmezzini, you know, I've got 70, yeah. So we're working on that right now for April or July. 70 people trained with the parable of the sower. We know what we're looking for now, right? And we're going to go down there, and we're going to go systematically, the 70 spread out, hitting all of the villages, sharing aggressively, openly, the word of God. But we're looking behind us also to see what's there, what comes up from that. He has other evangelists that will come in, you know. It is possible, it's rare, but we have seen people, just like the woman at the well, who just boom, 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 it just happens. Use the parable of the sower for casting vision. I think Jesus was using the parable to cast vision to a bunch of guys who said, Jesus, not many people are responding to you. You know, we see so many people rejecting you. And so he's going to tell them the parable, using it as a casting vision thing. So use it to cast vision for your 70 disciples that you're sending out. And by the way, the word disciple has movement inside of it. If you look it up in the dictionary, disciple, they'll have two definitions. One is the 12, the followers of Jesus. Second definition is one who spreads the doctrines or the teachings of a famous person. Okay, you're not a disciple, Austin. If you're, like today, right now, you're learning from me. If you don't go teach other people the parable of the sower, how to use it as strategy, you're just a student. You do not become a disciple until, I mean, you're just a believer, really. And I love that. I'm glad you accepted that. But you're not a disciple until you pass my teachings, my doctrines, on to another person. And then that person, he's not a disciple unless he... Do you see movement just in the world? Go into the world and make disciples. Go into the world and make movements is what I understand him to say. It has to keep going on in order for you to be a disciple or to... Making disciples, we say that all the time. What we mean by that is, I'm going to teach you from the Bible and you're going to get all of this information from the Bible. That's not how they were using it in the first century. A disciple is different from a believer. You want to come join me? You want to be one of my disciples? You got to be able to take the teachings and spread it. You don't do that, can't be my disciple. You're not serious about this. Systematically share the word of God in every. Now I can hold you accountable. You have chosen your Galilee. You said, I'm going to be like a farmer. I'm going to get the word of God all the way through there. I can ask you in a month, how you doing? Oh, we've got 10 cities already. We have shared the word of God inside those 10 cities. Well, what did you find? Well, we had these. Now I'm helping you process. Did you find a forceful person? Well, we found this one guy. He looks like a poor soul person. He smells like a poor soul person, but he's just not sharing. And then I'm going to say, give it one more month, but then move on. Keep going. Okay? Pay attention to poor soul people. If I could give you a visual, find a poor soul person, climb on his back, and he will take you into a movement. It works really good. Your tool belt that you have, Steve has been putting so many things, Chuck has been putting so many good tools on your tool belt. That's a powerful thing. That tool belt combined with a forceful person is what makes movements, what I have seen. I'm not sure all those 18 that I've researched, I just don't know if they would have actually gone and started the movements that they started without that person with the tool belt on. I don't know that because I don't have any examples of that. But I know for sure that that tool belt has come in so handy for these guys, helping them. Who spoke before me?
Stan
said correctly. He said, teams don't start movements out there. One of you, tool belt people, and a foresoul person starts movements. Okay? A little formula here. Urquhart Schnabel, do you know what country he's from? Urquhart Schnabel has given us such a good formula here. He doesn't go with the 204 villages and cities that Josephus says. He goes with another professor who says, a professor from Jerusalem, a seminary is there. This professor says he believes there were 138 towns and villages and cities in Galilee at that time. You can walk 2 hours, you can walk and be in the next community, village. I know that we always think Galilee is this huge place and all that. No, in 2 hours, you can be in the next place. We think Jesus only spent 2 days. Just read the woman at the well. It says he was 2 days there. The people in Capernaum say, hey, come, we like your teaching. Jesus says, I'm a fisherman. I got to be about my work. You know, it doesn't look like he stayed and made these disciples and started these churches. You get the point here. Jesus is on the move. So the formula is this. 2 days, 138 villages, only 2 hours of between all that. And we have 3 years of ministry there. Take out the Sabbaths. We're not going to be moving around on the Sabbaths. 11 and a half months. If Jesus was in each of the 138 communities for 2 days, it would only take him 11 and a half months. Go to this village, 2 days. Find, I don't want to sleep out under the stars. Find a person of peace who will take me in. I stay there. I'm going to saturate that whole area like a farmer does. I'm not going to keep moving from house to house looking for a place to park myself. I got one. And I'm going to win and, like a farmer, saturate this whole area here. 2 days, looks like. And then he moves on to the next place. Sabbath, off, and then it looks like you could cover, this is the idea, you can cover your Galilee in 11 and a half months. Are you starting? I hope this is my research. I'm beginning to understand how Jesus did ministry. I'm appreciating him as my mentor, strategy coordinator. I want to stand before Jesus one day and say, I'm sure I didn't do it exactly like you, but I studied, I tried to pay attention, I actually adopted your strategy, the parable of the sower, and Jesus, I tried to work exactly the way you did. Now, so far, this has been a big payoff in my life. I've seen 6 movements take off among a people group that's not supposed to be responsive to the gospel, Muslims. But it works really nice when you got the oikos factor going on. And you find that one person who Jesus told us is there, and he goes and starts that movement. Come on up. And any questions?
Hey, Kevin, could you give some range of time when a potential foresoul person is found? Like after gospel shared to when you actually say this is a foresoul person?
I'm not as fast as Jesus is. The woman at the well is pretty obvious there. And I'm trying to get better at this. I was just in Bangkok. I'm sitting with the missionary that I'm working with there. And we're delivering food to refugees. And this one guy walks up and he says, we get to talking. He's a Muslim from Pakistan, from the area that we're trying to go to with our Pakistan team. Okay, he's there. Why are you in Bangkok? Well, I'm a refugee because my wife and my daughter converted to Christianity. And these Muslims over there, he says, I'm a Muslim. He says he hadn't converted. He says he's 99% there. I don't know what that means, but that's what he said. And now my ears are tuned now. That's so odd. Muslims don't talk like that. That, you know, that their wife, and he blesses them, that they have followed their conventions and all that. That's not Muslim talk. This is something unusual going here. That's like walking into a community and a tax collector has climbed up in a tree just to see you. Train your eyes to see the unusual. That's what the parables are all about. They're helping us to reorientate our mind and our to opposites. Things in the kingdom are not dead. They're opposites. Ugly, broken things turn out to be mustard seed that... Okay. All right. So then he says that he is trying to start a movement. Now that's a movement. What are you talking about? He said... I'm trying to get the word out of people that are against Christians and against, you know, they shouldn't, one religion shouldn't do this to another religion. So, really? Wow, how are you spreading this? Now I'm checking to see about persecution. Okay, now he still hasn't got all the checkoff boxes. I don't know if he's a Christian yet. 99% there tells me, maybe I just don't know. I need to spend more time with him. But my ears are trained now to listen for this. So he said, I said, how are you, well, aren't you getting pushback? You talking this way to other Muslims? He said, I don't care what they do to me. This is right. I'm going to stand up for this. Okay. How are you getting your message out? He says, I go onto YouTube and I make my own videos and I put my messages on YouTube and I get out the message, all that. Now I'm wondering, are you a generous person? And so in the conversation, I didn't ask him, are you a generous person? But I'm listening for that. He said, last Christmas, I fed 200 Christians here in Pakistani Christians are just by the droves coming out of Pakistan into Bangkok there. He said, I fed 200 of them with my own money. How are you making money here? We do a little work, and I mean, not rich, in other words. He goes into the detention center, the jail, and he visits people inside there. You see how I'm trying to, he could be, if he just takes the gospel, he has the characteristics that I'm looking for. It could be right under my nose here. And again, the missionary that I'm working with, he totally missed that. Totally missed it. That guy can't. Anybody who says 99%, you know, believer in the Gospels, he can't do that. Well, just stay around just a little bit more and let's see what really is here. But your question is, what is the length of time? No less than 4 months. Seems to be the pattern for me, but it doesn't have to be that way. But it seems to be my time of knowing, is this person the person I'm going to go hang out with? Am I going to climb on this guy's back and together we're going to go start a movement? I need at least 4 months to see if he's the real deal. I need to see him pass through those soils, 2 and 3, you know, and pass through number 1 too. Is he going to listen to this thing here? Yeah. Good question. Anything else?
I have a question. How, so just using the metric that we've already thrown out there, so 1,000 baptized, right? From your experience, how many of those 1,000 is the poor soil baptizing and how much is he watching?
That's good. He only wins his oikos. And I think it was Chuck who said, or Ray, somebody said, four soil people catch four soil people. A movement, if I were to chart a movement up here, I have one somewhere in my computer there. It's a bunch of little movements all coming together. It's not one person who wins all the 1,000 and all that. That's what's like in Hollywood, okay? That's the way that you hear missionaries talk about it, because we don't go into details about the breakdown of that. We make it sound like this one person has led 30,000 people to Christ. No. He became just like me whenever he exhausted his oikos. Now he's a stranger, just like me, when he goes into that next place over there. not as strange as me, but because he's a Bengali and he speaks that local language. And, but if you look at a movement, it's made up of a bunch of little movements in there. People who go and do their hundredfold thing and win their families, and it all kind of, they decide, hey, let's join this Way of Peace network. And they have a designated leader, and he keeps the things going on like that. Main point I wanted you to get out of this little presentation is, I'm pondering about using the parable of the sower as my underlay strategy. I'm going to overlay my strategy on top of that. I want to see if I can get a reaction from people who are looking at my strategy and say, you sure look like a farmer throwing seed. That strategy you got going there, it sure looks like you're looking for somebody. I have actually stopped recently having goals of starting churches. That's a good goal. I don't mind that one bit. My goal for my Galilees are, I want at least 10 persons of, not person, there I go again. That means if I want a place to stay at night. I want to find 10 Fourth Soil people in this Galilee that I'm working on. Churches will come real quickly underneath those, because they're packaged that way, you know? I've never started any churches. Those Fourth Soil people are not as dumb as we think they are. They actually know how to, hey, we need to get together and learn more about this. Oh, get together, that looks like the formation of a church. It just happens that way. Now, they need some tools off my tool belt to help make that good and proper and work good and reproducible and all that. But it seems to, if you find a four-soul person, you know, the four fields? It goes a whole lot easier through those fields if you have a four-soul person and you're going through it with them. They know how to share with their people. They know how to evangelize their people. They know when their people are, you know, genuine or not. They know how to form groups. It's so much easier to do it that way. So, I've gone way over my time, and I apologize for that.
Is that good? Okay, here's what we're going to do, guys. We're going to take about a 23-minute break.